Hello and welcome to What You Need to Know. I am Sybil Wilkes and it is Black History. We're not only celebrating Juneteenth, but we are celebrating all of our history with an incredible project, a beautiful piece of work. And it is called Black History 365, an inclusive account of American history. My guests today are Dr. Walter Milton, Dr. Joel Freeman, and Dr. Kevin K.O. Cates. And we are talking about this incredible project. It is for, now, this is for a curriculum for our school system. So let's talk about how you all came together and what was the impetus for you all to put this together. Let's start at the beginning there.
Okay.
Who wants to go first? Dr. Walter? Okay.
Okay, I'll start it off. So I was a superintendent for over 13 years. And a gentleman had consistently came to my office and he said, "Hey, you have to meet this guy." And I'm like, "What dude? What guy?" He's from Black History. I said, "Okay, let me meet the brother. I like to meet the brother, no problem." So he came in and it was a white guy, Joel Freeman. I'm like, "Where's the brother, man?" So Joel and I, we had great conversations. He had an opportunity to talk to my cabinet. And he's very prolific in Black history. I mean, he loves Black people, love our history, and it's rich. And he knows that our history goes all the way back to the beginning of time. So over the years, many years we've known each other. We talked on the phone every now and then. And every time we spoke, it was just like we talked yesterday. Mm. So an idea hit me when I had a string of tragedies in my family. And I decided to break off and do my own thing. I resigned, started my own company. But then the light bulb went out. And I thought about my experience as an educator, and one thing that was missing, the fact that our children did not have an opportunity to know who they are. They have a rich history, very rich history. So I said, I'm going to take this opportunity, and I'm going to develop a curriculum in a textbook. And Joel Freeman was the first person that I called. He has really rich images that go all the way back to 1553. So I said, if we can have the opportunity to marry this, mm-hmm. we can do something that has never been done before in this country. And that's what we have. And we believe that this is going to be the spark to introduce our children to excellence and allow them to take their rightful stance as leaders in the world as we were before many years ago.
Dr. Joel Freeman, how does a white guy come up with all of this Black history knowledge? Where did your love of this and your sense of purpose in telling our history come from?
Well, I grew up in Canada, and a great question,
by the way.
That
seems a perfect place, yeah, to be caught up in Black history.
I left home when I was 17 to start hitchhiking all around North America for close to 2 years. And then, a long story short, I ended up in Baltimore, Maryland, and I became chaplain for the Washington Bullets, the Wizards in the NBA.
Then the Bullets, yes.
Yeah, I was one of the first chaplains in the history of the NBA. Did this for 20 seasons, survived 6 coaching changes, but you can imagine, I started when I was 25 years of age, but I looked like I was like 15 years of age. So the guys were thinking, I'm supposed to spill my guts to that guy? You got to be kidding me. And so he began to test the seams of my soul, asking me all sorts of questions. Of course, as a chaplain, you know, what did Jesus look like? And what part did African people play in biblical and extra biblical documents? And so in history. And so what happened is it forced me in a gentle and in a wonderful way to start studying. Then later I met another gentleman. We ended up co-writing a book together. But that was called Return to Glory. And then what happened is that I began to put together this Black History collection. Mm. And it's now grown to over 3,000 pieces. I just saw the power in the real. Because when you're around someone who can do anything, have anything, be anywhere they want, they tend to get a little jaded. But you put a handwritten letter by Frederick Douglass in their hands, an authentic letter signed by him, written by him, a certain humility, a teachability, a physicality takes over. And I saw the power of the real. And so I ended up doing some events. We had a huge event at the United Nations For 2 years in a row, over a million people showed up from around the world.
Wow.
The White House 3 times, Clinton Presidential Library 2 times, Secret Service about 8 times now, and a whole bunch of other venues. And just to kind of set it up and then just step back and just watch people of all ethnicities, ages, socioeconomic backgrounds, and they just lean over and lean into it. And so then when Walter called, I didn't have to think about it because I said to myself, this is what I've been preparing for. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize it. I tried to sell it 3 times and it never happened. And so I knew that this was something that was designed for this, for such a time as this. And of course, 2.5 years ago, we never know that this whole situation would be happening
right at
this time. And so for 2.5 years, I mean, we've gone for months, 12, 16 hour days, you know, and just going over this. And this is such a labor of love for us. And I'm such so honored to be hooked up with Dr. Walter Milton and Dr. Cates, and to be able to kind of shoulder along with this. And it's just, it's wonderful to be a part of this project.
So doctor, all get together and you incorporate K.O. Cates, Dr. K.O. Cates in this with the music too, because that is such a vital part of this. So tell me how that part of this relationship came in, K.O. Cates.
Well, it really hit where, you know, I've been knowing Joe for a long time, and Joe introduced me to Walter, and we were talking on the phone, and, you know, we were like, you know what, we just need to get together. So they both flew to Atlanta. You know, we hung out and came to the house, and I was sharing with them a lot of the things I'm doing on the education side. Mm-hmm. And you know, been doing that for over 13 years now, where we have Bridge the Gap that teaches character building and life skills through music, and Megan Good, the actress, and myself actually teaches the course.
Wow.
And, you know, we've been around for over 13 years now, stopping suicide, gang wars, and things like that through music. So I knew the power of music and education was the key. And it was also a thing to me to where it was just my calling of saying, okay, God gave me a gift. I have to do more with it. And then I went on to do K-12 education, math, science, social studies, and English, literally over 600 songs all taught through hip hop. So I was displaying this to Joe and Walter, and, you know, we just got the vibing, and they were showing me the book, and I'm like, yo, we got to do it. We got to tie the music in, and, you know, the same way it is on the other platforms that I'm doing. And at that point, I was just blown away with the actual history, because
right.
I'm from Montgomery. Oh, I was raised in Montgomery, Alabama. So we had what you call Alabama history. But
yes.
It only stuck to the key things, Rosa Parks, you know, the march. But when I started seeing all of the chapters and seeing, wow, this happened. These are tribes in Africa that I knew nothing about. There
right.
were battles fought, you know, before slaves were brought over here. That
before
I knew nothing
1600s,
about.
Yeah.
So I'm like, wow, like, okay, I got to have, I got to be a part. So at that point, Joe and Walter were getting me all of the units for each chapter, and then I began to create songs that narrates what happened in that time. So
yeah.
We can capture, you know, whether it's some kids learn visuals, some auditory, you know, but we make sure that they get it by all means necessary.
So that's the beauty, Dr. Milton and Dr. Freeman, that you understand, and from an educational standpoint, understand that it's not just one way that any child learns. A whole classroom, a whole curriculum, a whole school, the entire country, if you will. Everybody has their own individual ways of learning, and you've been able to incorporate this. So, but your understanding of this had to take a lot of work in order to determine what are we going to put in here? What's going to grab that kid? What's going to stick with them? What's going to make them want to go to the next chapter and find things? So how difficult was that? And what was that conversation like between the two of you, especially?
Exactly. We talked about what's already out there. Our kids are so used to hearing the traditional aspects of Black history. So we wanted to do something that was much more in depth. So we started by looking at the etymology of the word Africa. And we got all the way down to Akubalon, which means the Garden of Eden. And so it goes all the way back to the beginning of time. And then we came up through the whole African experience. And then we talked about the transatlantic slave trade. And we go all the way up to George Floyd in our textbook. And so we wanted to be non-traditional, if you will. And we wanted to share what we had unearthed in terms of our in-depth research. And like Joe alluded to, our 16-hour days that we had. And sometimes it seemed like this book is godly inspired, because I'm like, man, we wrote that? that I was writing, you know, fighting back the tears, or can't even see the screen because I'm crying for, you know, what we experienced. And I would say that the ones, our ancestors who made it through all of that, we're descendants of those people. So we have greatness in our blood, in our veins. And if our children knew that, they would take hold of the educational process and they would really connect themselves. So one thing that we had to do, we wanted to make sure we were legitimate in our task. Mm-hmm. So we did a study. We wanted to see if there was a direct correlation with culturally responsive education and student achievement. And we did find it. And we find that many of our children, scores of them in many urban school districts across the country, private schools, they are disconnected from the educational process because they don't see themselves in it. Wow. I had one little girl tell me, you know, are we going to learn about ourselves? Because, you know, what we're taught is that we think that white people invented air. I mean, it was comical, but it made a lot of sense.
But that's got to hit you. I mean, that's like, that takes the air out of you when you hear something like that.
It did. So we deconstructed that comment and we said, what we're going to do is put together something called, and we use a model called the DRC model, to deconstruct, to reconstruct, and to construct, to tear it apart, to analyze it, and to put it together in the way in which it's going to lift all of our young people to become solutionists of this world.
Wow. So we're talking about Black History 365, and it's called An Inclusive Account of American History. Dr. Joel, can you show us the book that you are so proud of and you should be? It is beautiful. and it is a construction, it is a project of great love and a great scholarship, and it is a curriculum. It is incredible when you start with ancient Africa, as you say, and you go all the way to George Floyd. It's mind-boggling. And you say these 16-hour days, right? Where do you start 500 years that you bring into one curriculum? Are we talking about from September to December for a classroom? Are we talking about September to June? How do you see this going in the classroom?
Well, what we're thinking about is that this, in some school systems, they might want to do like unit 1 and 2 with mm-hmm. ninth grade, the next 3 units in the 10th grade and 2 and then 3, you know, just go through all the 10 units that way. Some may want to do it all in 1 year. Mm. And then we're developing what we're calling the Solutionist Academy, which is after school or on Saturdays. Gotcha. And that can be a community contact and a whole different approach. Because one of the things that we did in the very beginning was we developed a SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. We celebrated the strengths. We checked the boxes and about the opportunities. And we looked at all of the tremendous ways that this could impact our culture, starting in kindergarten. But then we looked at especially at the weaknesses and the threats. Because this is a history book, but at the same time, we're dealing with topics that will cause certain thoughts and emotions to gurgle to the surface. And so we had to think of how are we going to approach this. So we developed what we affectionately call the elephant experience.
Yes, and I was going to ask you about that. Yes.
It's a proprietary process. In fact, we've trademarked it. And it's where we have identified 52 elephant experiences. It's like if you're at a restaurant, let's say a Thai restaurant or a Chinese or a Mexican restaurant, you open up the menu and you see the little red pepper up in the corner of one in the dish. And you intuitively know that's going to be hot and spicy. And some are repelled by that. Some are attracted to that. Well, what we did is we got this funky, hippy-dippy looking elephant, mystically looking elephant, and that becomes our red pepper. So anytime the students, and we're preparing them, we have a whole proprietary process for preparing them for the elephant experiences. We, you know, topics like reparations, are we in a post-racial society after a black president, three-fifths of a human being, Uncle Tom, should we tear down the statues? All those different topics that people end up butting heads on, mm-hmm. or talk past each other or unfriend each other or block each other on Facebook over, because we just want to have a healing atmosphere that deals with the topics at hand. So what we did, I'll show you this right here. This is what's known as a talking stick from the mid-1850s. And this is from the Chukwe tribe in Angola. And you can see the kalimba, which is a thumb piano. And we introduce this to the students. And then we have a process where they make their own talking stick. And they use this on those elephant experiences, maybe for the first 3 weeks. And then after that, it's just like, hey, Sally, Tim has a talking stick. And you know what that means.
That's right.
metaphor. And so we're just trying to create something. We have created something that is so different from anything else. I don't care what other companies come up with a Black History curriculum. We know we have 8 distinctives as to how we are different from every other Black History curriculum out there in the comprehensive nature from K through 12, student engagement, teacher, the professional development process. Because any teacher that's teaching this, they have to do their own archaeology, whether they're Black or white, young or old, male or female, Hispanic, whoever. And so they can then provide an atmosphere of learning for the students that is just at a whole nother level.
This is a long way from that book that we used to have on our coffee table at my house, Great Negroes Past and Present.
I have a copy of that.
Right? But this is an incredible project. Did you ever get to a point where in editing this, that you had to say, we can't put this in, or, you know, we gotta, you know, the editing process just had to be unbelievable.
Walter?
Yes, we have. you know, we...
This is volume one.
right.
So when we started this, we realized that this is only volume one. Yeah. And there's several other volumes to follow because the history is so expansive. When people read this book, and we want it not only to be for students in academia, but we want it to be for the whole world.
Yes.
Because many adults have not healed from their past, and because many of us don't know our history.
Right.
And I think that, you know, our decision-making, the outlook that we have on life, the way that we treat each other, the way that we do commerce and business with each other would change if we know that we are really a collective people. And so by us being a collective people, we have a responsibility on our shoulders to help the whole world to become collective, because that's what was expected out of us as a people. But we lost that through, you know, slavery. And I say that slavery is nothing but an interruption of who we are. You know, because we go all the way back almost to the beginning of time, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I think that we have to really ignite the spirit of our people, because they will ignite the spirit, because it's intuitive nature in us to ignite the spirit of everyone else, the whole world.
Incredible, and I'm a long way from the classroom, but those of us that are not in the classroom, we can still get this book, can't we?
Yes.
How do we do that? And how do parents get this into their school system? Where do we go?
There's a website. It's blackhistory365education.com. That's blackhistory365education.com. And I'll just share this with you also, is that when we did the SWOT analysis and everything, we came up with our mission, and it's 4 things that we hope, because our whole focus is on the students. When we're doing a sidebar elephant experience, we're thinking, okay, how are the students going to relate? Is this sticky? Is it engaging? Or is it sustained? Is the engagement sustained? And here's 4 things. Number 1, We wanted to have something that would invite students and faculty and parents to become critical thinkers, number one. Number two, compassionate listeners. Mm. Number three, fact-based, respectful communicators. And number four, probably the most important, but you got to have the first three before you get the four, is action-based solutionist. Mm.
You are preaching to the choir here, but I think that you have touched so many chords in all of this, if I may use that analogy, Kale, or that description, because it is, and you talk about so many different people, including our very own founder, Kathy Hughes. She is a part of this Black history, isn't she?
That's right. And she is on our advisory board. She joins people like Ambassador Andrew Young. We have also Benjamin Crump, who's the lawyer for many unfortunate situations. We have also Paul Griffin, who is the former VP of Houghton Mifflin. We have a number of individuals. We have Bill Haley Jr., who's the grandson of Alex Haley for Roots. We have Agbara Bryson, who's a great, great nephew of Annie Malone, who was the one who taught Madam C.J. Walker.
Yes.
We have so many different people on the advisory board, and it just, we want to have something that superintendents can look at this and say, oh, should we do it? Or is this going to cause more trouble? Oh, wait a minute. Ambassador Andrew Young is on here.
Right.
Advisory.
Right.
So we wanted to have something that would be smooth and the parents could let down their guard and say, let's do this. And this is a grand experiment. We're a bunch of merry adventurers. And let's do this. because every time there's an unfortunate situation in our country, there's people get on TV, talking heads that say, you know, we need to have a national conversation about this. And Walter and I, we felt, let's start in kindergarten with contextualized conversations so that we can start a whole new generational move toward talking about these tough matters in a manner that is healing to our nation.
Absolutely. Before we wrap up, I want to bring you back into this, Kale, because as I talk about the music and the importance of the marriage of all of this, what was your favorite section or part to work on for this? If there was one, it could be like your children, and there is no favorite, but is there one that a piece of music that sticks with you?
You know, there's one in particular that with the middle, we're talking about the triangle, and we're just talking about the slave trade altogether. Mm-hmm. And there's one, and it's just a song about slavery altogether, and it covers a very big part of that whole piece. And that was actually one that I presented when Walter and Joe told me about everything. And it's just a powerful piece that covers, it blankets history, and it covers, you know, from slavery to pretty much when it was abolished. Mm-hmm. So it's that record means a lot to me. Now, as we're going in depth, it's like I'm capturing, it's like an ongoing series.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, you can only capture so much in the song to where you don't give them too much info. So it's like I have a bunch of them all like my babies, but that record means a lot to me because it actually covers the broad spectrum of it. So, you know.
This is so inspiring and so needed. And as you make your debut, as we're talking on the eve of Juneteenth and all of the things that are going on in our country, this could not have happened at a better time, gentlemen. I want to thank you. And once again, we are talking about Black History 365, an inclusive account of American history, covering 500 years of hard work on the part of all of these gentlemen and telling our stories and bringing this to life for our children. That is so very vital. I want to thank you so much for taking the time today to talk to us about this. And as we like to do on our newsletter, What You Need to Know, there's a lot we need to know, and it is in this book. And this is just the first volume.
Thank you
so much. We have been talking to Dr. Walter Milton Jr., Dr. Joel Friedman, and to Dr. Kevin K.O. Cates. Thank you so much for joining us. Once again, show us the book, will you, Dr. Freeman?
Yes.
Beautiful. Black history, and that is what we are all about in telling our stories. Thank you so much for telling your story and about your project, and look forward to it. And I got to get my copy. I'm just saying, I'm waiting here. Thank you all so much for joining us
today. Thank you.
God bless you.
God bless.